used to escape here to watch cows being milked and to perform in little plays about the lives of milkmaids and peasants. It's another eerie place, a fantasy stage set for a woman who clearly didn't have the faintest idea of what peasant life was actually like. And yet it's the forerunner of every neo-vernacular housing estate in the Western world. Marie Antoinette's reasons for liking this kind of peasant architecture are simple enough to read. Basically, she'd had enough of luxurious palace life, of mirrors, gold, marble, and long state dinners, and she was looking to rustic architecture to help her to rebalance her character, to put her in touch with sides of her personality she was afraid of losing touch with. And in a way, nowadays in the modern Western world, we've all followed in the footsteps of Marie Antoinette. The general trend towards the rustic, towards a kind of fake country living, reflects the fact that we are in fact very far away from this kind of country life. We're looking to rustic architecture precisely because we're so very unrustic in our souls. One can sympathise with Marie Antoinette's problems with the Palace of Versailles. It is oppressively ornate and formal. A few hours there does make you long for something simpler. And yet, wandering around the Queen's Hamlet today, you sense that it's not Marie Antoinette's complaints with the world around her that were misguided. It's how she responded to them. The problem is that she fell for a delusion. It's not just that most peasants lived in grinding misery and often longed to escape their scenic villages. It's that rather than grappling with reality, rather than trying to reform French upper-class life to make it less decadent and ornate, she fled from it. Rather than trying to make the real world properly habitable, she ran away to a make-believe home, while the reality just got worse and worse. Till a revolutionary mob came to bash down the gilded doors of Versailles and dragged her off to the guillotine. We seem in danger of responding to many of the problems of modern reality with the same lack of sophistication and courage as Marie Antoinette. The danger in our reality comes from a very different direction. Our world seems too brutal, too technological, too industrial. We see an ugly landscape taking shape of trading estates, factories, and shopping malls, and the prospect frightens us. In the early 20th century, a German philosopher and art historian by the name of Wilhelm Voringer came up with a fascinating thesis for why it is that certain societies and individuals will fall in love with certain kinds of architecture. His premise was that we fall in love in architecture with what we don't have enough of in ourselves. So the rustic style, infused as it is with the qualities of quaintness and simplicity, will appeal chiefly to societies where progress has been too fast, where there's an atmosphere of moral and spiritual confusion, and so a hungering for old certainties. Against such a turbulent background, inhabitants will experience what Voringer termed an immense longing for tranquility, and so we'll turn to country cottages to regain a peace of mind. Dorian Bowen works in a large firm of surveyors in central London. Every weekend, he drives for 4.5 hours into rural Carmarthenshire and lives in a caravan while he lovingly restores a rustic cottage. Now, your dream for the cottage is to bring it back as faithfully as possible to how it must have been in its heyday. I mean, that's the goal.
Yes, to be as authentic as one practically can be and faithful to the period, as it were. This would have been the heart of the house, really. Everything was done around the fire. I mean, as you can see, even the furniture actually goes inside the fireplace itself.
So you stay as close to the warmth.
Yes, and all the cooking and everything was done in the fire. And of course, the last little feature was the pigsty. This has been converted into the outside toilet.
So you're converting it, but not into a ensuite.
No, it's completely outside.
So people will have to go outside of the house in winter, say, to go to the loo.
Yes.
As Vorringer would have pointed out, it takes a deeply urban person to feel the attraction of living in an 18th century cottage. Like Marie Antoinette, we long for a simpler, more authentic life, longings that we think a country cottage will assuage.
So, Doran, how do you imagine your life once work in the cottage is done and everything is set up? How will you spend your days here?
Sure, exactly.
Have you not thought about that?
Yeah. look for another project, maybe.
I recommend it to anybody that they have a house full of bears. They'll never be miserable.
Vorringer's ideas apply as much to how we do up the interiors of our houses as to their outward design. We're drawn to a style of decor because it seems to contain qualities in which we're deficient. So a given stylistic choice will tell us as much about what its advocates lack in their lives as what they like on their walls. The harsher and more frightening we perceive the modern world to be, the more we might want our houses to speak of softness and coziness.
There's a bear.
Susan French started collecting teddy bears as a girl.
His name is Bob.
Old Bob.
Old Bob.
She and her late husband built up a collection that now numbers 800.
So the bears are a comfort?
Oh, yes, definitely. But they always were in childhood. You know, when you come home from school and life was a bit... You got your bear and everything was okay.
Yeah. Why do you think people stop sort of hugging their bears? Because it's...
Probably because they don't feel very grown up, but I don't care. Yeah. I think people are often sort of care about what other people think, and I never have.
Why do you feel a strong need for that kind of cosiness and comfort?
I don't know, all my life I've liked to be cosy and comfortable, and my mum and dad were very loving and we always had a lovely, cosy, happy house, and I guess I wanted to recreate that and pass it on.
What's the opposite of cosy for you when it comes to a house or a space or an atmosphere?
Minimalism.
That's the opposite of cosy.
Bare floorboards, one television in the corner and a couple of leather chairs. And very smart, and sometimes I think, oh, it'd be lovely to have this, and then I think, oh, no, I couldn't live like that.
There's nothing wrong with wanting our homes to give us comfort and security. It's how we go about it that counts. Surely the best way to deal with what we don't like about the modern world isn't to pretend that that world never happened.
If we're saying that the rustic style of architecture is all about getting us to forget reality, we could say, well, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with a little delusion? Any attack on delusion probably comes back to the idea that escaping the facts always has a price that you have to pay for doing so. The German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche talked about a mature adult always being someone who no longer denies, who looks at the truth in the face.
Nietzsche said, "The worst sickness of men tends to originate in the sentimental way they try to combat their sicknesses. What seems like an easy cure, in the long run, produces something worse than what it's supposed to overcome. Fake consolations always have to be paid for with a general and profound worsening of the original complaint."
So how does Nietzsche